Everybody in here? We'll go ahead and get started a few minutes early, because if we don't, you'll fall asleep. And I don't want that to happen. So I wanted to show a few pictures, and I wasn't planning to do this at the beginning, but my phone's, the battery's getting real low, and I'm afraid it's going to die on me. So we'll go ahead and show you a few pictures. This is from Southeast Kentucky, from the Perry County, where my wife is from, Hazard. I mentioned this morning that they had 11 inches of rain in just a few hours. And my father-in-law said this is the worst anything, any natural disaster in his lifetime. He's, you know, mid-60s. Thank you. And can you turn these three lights off over there? So I'm just going to go through my phone and show a couple videos and pictures, help us to know a little bit more about it, how to more effectively pray for them. And I'm trying to reach out to some pastor friends and see if there's any efforts that they're putting forth as far as maybe collecting money, or there's just so many things that these people need. They've lost everything. And if I can nail down a good source, then I might present it if folks want to help, or maybe the church could help a little bit. It's pretty sad, and I'm just thank the Lord for our blessings. But I'll use this microphone so I can turn around here. This is home of Jimmy Keen, my father-in-law's boss that he worked for until a couple years ago, and then he retired, and my father-in-law has that position now. He's the supervisor. No insurance on this house. So you can see this is almost, water's almost up to the roof line there. So it'd be a total loss, I would say. This is tragic here. These four little children got swept away in the floodwaters. And, there for several hours a day, they couldn't find them. Then my mother-in-law texted me this. They found them, but they didn't make it. They were all four passed away. I think there were 16 total lives lost. Let me see if I can... This is that church I was saying about, a Baptist church there. Some of our cousins, my wife's cousin's family, attended this church. This is mud. The water is already receded out, but you can see the footprints of mud down through there. That pew had floated up and is just sitting there. You can see just... devastation. We can kind of understand. We live in a flood area. We've been through the floods. These folks weren't expecting it. They didn't have time to do anything. And, it actually started in the night on Wednesday night. It's kind of interesting. There was forecasted heavy rains, and everybody has a phone now, so the alerts were going off on the phones all night, but still, some people, for whatever reason, were caught. You see the water line right there on the wall. So what is that, about 3 foot water in that church? 4 foot? That's a Davison Baptist Church. This morning, they met in the parking lot at church. That's amazing. That's what church is all about. And if we didn't have a building, didn't have anything else, we ought to still want to be in church, to sing, to praise the Lord, to hear the preaching. Let me see if I can find this real quick here. I didn't have all this stuff put together yet. This is some videos from a state representative, Brandon Smith, friends of ours. I wanted to show you this video here. So he has some, it looks like Army National Guard footage that he was made available to, rescuing people and different things. And here's a flyover video. It's hard to see, but it's all flooded houses and buildings down below. Let me just pause it here. You can see these hills, the Appalachian Mountains. They're not huge mountains. It would be bigger than the Ozarks, I think, of Missouri, but it's not like Colorado. But you have to understand, when you have a flash flood, all the hills and valleys, the water just creates a river. You know, there's nowhere else to go. So where there isn't rivers and things, all of a sudden now there are, and that's why so many people got flooded. You can see just water everywhere. Another problem they face is the roads. You know, they're not used to heavy waters like this. And so the roads are washed out, the little bridges are washed out. Even where my father-in-law lives, even though their house is on high ground, they couldn't get out of the holler. They live 3 miles back off the main highway because the roads are washed out. And so now, and there's one way in, one way out, and so you're stuck. How do you even get out? She has a pickup truck, and he was able to go through the old logging roads, and he's lived there all his life, and get out to the main roads to get out. But it's just devastation. We could go on and on. I'm not going to spend a lot of time trying to navigate through these. I wasn't real prepared for that. But I wanted to just show you a few things. And, you know, it's always good to have a mindset of thankfulness to the Lord. Amen. And counting our blessings. And that's kind of what I just want to do this afternoon, is sing some songs to the Lord, take a few favorites. And let's start off with count your blessings. Did you find that? Somebody holler that number out to me if you find it. It's a new hymnal, so I don't... 456. 456. Count your blessings. Name them one by one. 456. You be thinking of a favorite song, let's just sing to the Lord for a little while this afternoon. When upon life's billows you are tempest tossed, when you are discouraged, thinking all is lost, count your many blessings, name them one by one, and it will surprise you what the Lord hath done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God hath done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God hath done. Verse 4, so amid the conflict, whether great or small, do not be discouraged, God is over all. Many blessings angels will attend, help and comfort give you to your journey's end. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God hath done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God hath done. Let's have a word of prayer. We'll start the service, and then we'll take a few favorite songs. Thank you, Lord, for this day. It's been good already to be in church. We thank you for sweet spirit that's been here today and the fellowship. And Lord, this afternoon we want to just kind of change the tune of of the day. And Lord, we just want to love on you, and we just want to thank you for your blessings. And we want to just let you know how much we truly do love you. Lord, I pray that you'd help everything to go according to your plan and what we do here in this hour. And Lord, draw us close to you. We sure are thankful and grateful. In Christ's name I pray, amen and amen. Let's take a few favorites, and we'll just sing for a few minutes. And Miss Dana, 418. You might have to use the index now to get your correct page numbers. Oh, I like this one. He's the Master of the Sea. Page 418. One night upon the sea, a ship was tossing to and fro. Breakers dashed on every hand, angry winds around it blow. All on board were filled with pride as the mighty billows rolled. Then they called upon the one who the winds and waves controlled. When he reaches out his hand, billows cease at his command. Winds and waves obey his will when he says to them, be still. What man is this, they all did say, that the winds and waves obey? He's the one who sails with me. He's the master of the sea. Though the storms of life may rage and the billows round you roll, he can calm life's troubled sea as he did in days of old. As upon life's sea you sail, trust in him who never fails. I'm so glad he sails with me. He's the master of the sea. When he reaches out his hand, billows cease at his command. Winds and waves obey his will when he says to them, be still. What man is this, they all did say, that the winds and waves obey? He's the one who sails with me. He's the master of the sea. That's a good one. I'm not saying that in a long time. Dylan, number 58. And Can It Be? Good song. We'll sing the first verse. 58. And can it be that I should gain an interest in the Savior's blood? Died he for me, who caused his pain for me, who him to death pursued? Amazing love, how can it be that thou, my God, shouldst die for me? Amazing love, how can it be that amazing love for sure. Miss Angie, number two. Come Thou Fount. It's a good old song here. Tune thy heart to sing thy grace. Ready? Come Thou Fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, all for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount I'm fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming. We got to sing that third verse. Tremendous, tremendous words. Oh, to grace, how great a debtor. Well, we're debtors today, folks. We owe the Lord so many things. Let thy goodness bind my wandering heart. We ought to love God for who he is. We ought to serve him, not because of fear, not because of we might get corrected. No, because of his goodness to us. And that third line, we're prone to wonder, aren't we? Prone to wonder. Sing it out on that third.
Oh, to grace, how great a debtor, daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy goodness, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it for thy courts above.
Kinsey. 534. Now, if I don't know this, you have to come sing it. Oh, I don't know this. Can you come sing it? I'm just teasing. No, not one. That's a good one. 534.
There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one. No, not one. None else could heal all our souls' diseases. No, not one. No, not one. Jesus knows all about our struggles. He will guide till the day is done. There's not a friend like the lonely Jesus. No, not one. No, not one.
I want just the children to sing the third verse. Okay, look at verse 3. There's not an hour that he is not near us. No night so dark, but his love can cheer us. All right, y'all sing it out really good here. Ready? On verse 3. There's not an hour. Sing it good.
No night so dark, love can cheer us.
Everybody now,
Jesus knows all about our struggles. He will guide till the day is done. There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one. No.
That last
was there a gift like the Savior given? No, not one. No, not one. Will he refuse us a home in heaven? No, not one. No, not one. Jesus knows all about our struggle. He will guide till the day is not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one.
Turn over to page 532, just back one page. Here's the answer right here. Jesus is still the answer. Anybody know this song? It's an old gospel song. All right, we're going to learn a new song. I'll sing a solo, I guess, for a while till you learn it. And then y'all help me out. Jesus is still the answer. Ready?
Some men try so hard to prove that God's not really real, while others say they know for sure His love you cannot feel. But I know He's real within my soul, for one day He cleansed and made me whole. And Jesus is still the answer for that longing deep in your soul. Jesus is still the answer, and though time and ages roll, Jesus is still the answer. He's the answer for your soul. And though some may say He doesn't fit with their philosophy, I know Jesus is still the answer. He's always been and always will be. Some men pretend that things of this world have brought them peace of mind, but with the dawn of each new day, new thrills they try to find. Not until they meet the Prince of Peace can they ever hope to find relief. For Jesus is still the answer for a world that's seeking for peace. Jesus is still the answer, and though time and ages roll, Jesus is still the answer. He's the answer for your soul. And though some may say He doesn't fit with their philosophy, I know Jesus is still the answer. He's always been and always will be.
That's a great one. I enjoyed that. I think it is. Let me see what. I'm looking here. Page 474. 474. I'd rather have Jesus. Amen. 474.
I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather be His than have riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than houses or lands. I'd rather be led by His nail-pierced hand than to be the king of a vast domain, or be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today.
That third verse,
He's fairer than lilies of rarest bloom. He's sweeter than honey from out of the comb. He's all that my hungering spirit needs. I'd rather have Jesus and let Him lead than to be the king of a vast domain, or be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today.
Miss Ruth, we'll get to you, Shelley, in a minute. 22. I'm liking this. This is good singing. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Number 22. Sing that first verse.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
Miss Shelley, you say three? Number three. Brethren, we have met to worship.
Brethren, we have met to worship and adore the Lord our God. Will you pray with all your power while we try to preach the word? All is vain unless the Spirit of the Holy One comes down. Brethren, pray, and holy manna will be showered all around.
Carmen. 334 at Calvary. That's a good one.
Years I spent in vanity and pride, caring not my Lord was crucified. Knowing not it was for me He died on Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. Kinsley.
423. Okay, 423. Let's see what it is here. Is it 423, my wonderful Lord? You know it? I think I know it.
I have found a deep peace that I never had known, and a joy this world could not afford. Since I yielded control of my body and soul to my wonderful, wonderful Lord. My wonderful Lord, my wonderful Lord, by angels and seraphs. My Savior divine, my wonderful, wonderful.
Let's sing another verse. That second one's a good one. I desire that my life shall be ordered by thee. Here we go. Ready?
I desire that my life shall be ordered by thee, that my will be in perfect accord with thine own sovereign will, thy desires to fulfill. My wonderful, wonderful Lord, my wonderful Lord, my wonderful Lord, by angels and seraphs in heaven adored, I know thou art mine, my Savior divine, my wonderful, wonderful Lord.
That's a great one. All right, we're going to change gears for a minute. I gotta get another drink. All right, I want my boys to come up. Lainey, you can come too. I've had a song on my heart. We've not sang this before, but I just we listen to it all the time, and we're gonna see if we can do it. Y'all come stand over here. A song titled "I Can't Quit," and. I think we all probably, well, I know we do. You have times in your life where you say, just throw in the towel. Let's just do something different. And Jeremiah said, I can't quit when there's a fire burning in my soul. And there's just something down deep that says, no, can't do it. I love this song. I don't know how it's going to go. We might fall flat on our face on this one. But... it's got a great, great message, so here we go.
Deceive me, oh Lord, you've done me wrong. I've been out here preaching faithfully, seems you've left me all alone. So I said, I'll not speak or mention your name at all, but your word is like a fire burning in my bones. I can't quit when there's a fire burning in my soul. Sometimes I want to lay it down. He gives me strength to carry on. I know while on this battlefield, sometimes we'll face defeat, but I can't quit when there's a fire burning in me.
So many are quitting, they're laying down the sword. They've grown weary in this battle, we are fighting for our Lord. But when I think of what he did on the cross of Calvary, I take up the blood-stained banner and march with the redeemed.
I can't quit when there's a fire burning in my soul. Sometimes I want to lay it down. He gives me strength to carry on. I know while on this battlefield, sometimes we'll face defeat, but I can't quit when there's a fire burning in me.
I know
while on this battlefield, sometimes we'll face defeat, but I can't quit when there's a fire burning in me.
I can't quit when there's a fire burning in me. Take your Bible, and Brother Chester, I'm going to have you sing in just a minute, but I want you to turn to Romans. I'll read this verse, and I'll have Brother Chester come and sing. And I'll give you a quick thought this afternoon, and I don't know, I just love the Lord. Amen. I feel like the older I get, the more I fail Him. That's just the honest truth, but we just keep on going. Amen. We keep on trying. Romans chapter 1 and verse number 18. Romans 1:18. Of course, this is the Apostle Paul writing and writing to the church here at Rome. It says, "For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness. Because that which may be known of God is manifest in them, for God hath showed it unto them. For the invisible things of Him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even His eternal power and Godhead, so they are without excuse." I mean, He's just letting them have it right here. There's no excuse for it at all. But I want you to notice what He says in verse number 29. "Because that when they knew God, they glorified Him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened." I wonder sometimes, do I fall into that category? Do we glorify God as God? Do we realize who He is? Do we worship Him truly as we should? So many times we get caught in this rut, don't we? I tell you what, I've enjoyed this last month. It's been a busy month for us as we've been in meetings, been to camp, and then we're in another meeting this past week. And man, I tell you what, my heart is doing pretty good right now. I hate to say that because the devil hears me. Man, I feel like I'm about where I should be. The Lord's good to us. I mean, I've been in so many, I don't even know how many times I've been preached at this month, probably 30 or 40 times. And, you know, I don't want to get in a rut of church. I don't want to get in a rut of walking with the Lord. I want it to be special every time. I really, truly do. The Bible says they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful. And today, I just want to be thankful. Just want to be thankful. And the Lord sure is good. I'm going to pray. Brother Chester, come sing this song, then I'll come back and give you a thought here. Thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to open your word. We've been singing praises to you. And Lord, my heart's already been helped, been full of your goodness. And Lord, I pray as we spend the next few minutes in your word, you'll just tug on our hearts. And Lord, help us to know the goodness that you have, the goodness that you've shown to us. Bless this song, Lord. I pray it be a blessing to us as we get ready for the preaching. In Jesus' name, amen.
The name of the song is Because He Lives.
Amen.
He came to this earth to lead us all to the cross of Calvary.
Amen.
Because He lives. God sent His Son. They call Him Jesus. He came to love, heal, and forgive. He lived and died
Chester. Appreciate that. Romans is a pretty amazing book. I love the gospel plan given in Romans. Very clear gospel presentation found in Romans chapter 3 through Romans chapter 5, Romans chapter 6, Romans chapter 10, just all through there. And we really see the foundation of what should motivate us as a Christian, our love for the Lord, our thankfulness to Him. He died on the cross for us. We see that in Romans. Turn with me to Romans chapter 12. Just trying to keep this story here. We read a verse in Romans 1 about unthankfulness. We see the gospel in chapters 3, 4, 5, chapter 10. We get to Romans chapter 12. He says in verse number 1, and do you kind of follow his thought progress or thought pattern now and the progression? And as he's talked about the Lord and now in chapter 12, he says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And he's challenging the church here and those at Rome. He says, after all that God has done for you, I mean, isn't the least that we can do? He said, it's your reasonable sacrifice or reasonable service. He said, just give your bodies to the Lord to serve Him. Just sacrifice Him. And I think the greatest motivation that we can have to live for the Lord, to serve Him, is probably number one, thankfulness. A gratitude is one of the biggest motivating factors that we should have as a Christian, being thankful for who the Lord is, for what He's done. Obviously, right up there is our love for Him. And our love ought to constrain us. It's amazing to me in the story of the Lord healing the 10 lepers. And they came to Him, and of course, they were healed of their leprosy. Jesus healed all 10 of them. And out of the 10 that Jesus healed, the Bible says there was only one that came back to thank Him. That's amazing to me. I'm not going to go into the story of leprosy. We know how awful of a condition that is. And I would think that after living in that condition of, well, having to be away from your family, you had to live outside the city, and the awful condition that it was and how just terrible it was to have to deal with that day in and day out, that you wouldn't thank the Lord for it. But yet only one did. And Jesus said, where are the nine? And I don't want to be one of the nine, amen. I want to be that one of the 10. People can take a miracle for granted and not be thankful, can't they? Perhaps not being thankful is one of man's greatest sins. One of our greatest sins, unthankfulness. You know, if we're not careful, that is what the grace of God can do to us. It can blind us to how good God really is. When we think about God's grace, young people, kids, you know what grace is? It's God not giving me what I do deserve. Oh, no, I'm sorry, that's mercy. Grace is God giving me something special that I don't deserve. It's His blessings on my life. It's Him giving me salvation. It's Him giving me forgiveness of sins. I don't deserve that. And when I see the grace of God, when I see the mercy of God, mercy is me not getting what I deserve. I deserve a whooping, amen. I deserve to go to hell, but God, He has spared that from me. I'm covered by God's grace, and sometimes that grace blinds me to how good God really is. You know, just living in America, we're just naturally ungrateful. We don't know how good we have it. We don't. I don't know if anyone has lived anywhere else other than the United States, but listen, we've got it made. and we become blind to the goodness of God. Ed Spencer was a hero of one of the worst shipwrecks ever on Lake Michigan. Mr. Spencer was studying for the ministry in seminary in Evanston, Illinois. On the night of September 8, 1860, he was awakened by the shouts of other students in the dormitory. A shipwreck had taken place not far away. An excursion ship had collided with a lumber freighter, and 400 people were out in the cold water struggling for survival. Ed jumped up, dressed, and ran 3 miles to the lake. A strong undertow had discouraged many who would have become rescuers, but Ed was a strong swimmer, so he plunged into the chilly waters. The waves were high and debris hit and cut him, but he was able to make 15 trips and saved 15 lives. Mr. Spencer was resting by a fire, drinking a cup of coffee, when the shout came, "There are two more!" In spite of his exhaustion, he plunged into the surf again and made it to a piece of wreckage where a man and woman were clinging for life. He brought them in, and then he collapsed. 287 people drowned that day. 98 survived. 17 of those survived because of Ed Spencer. Mr. Spencer never did become a minister. His body had been so severely weakened, and he became an invalid who lived out his days in California. As an older man, he was interviewed in Los Angeles, and he was asked what he remembered about the great rescue. "Only this," he replied, "of the 17 people I saved, not one of them even thanked me." We're talking about living in a day of unthankfulness. Unthankfulness. I mentioned out of the 10 of lepers that Jesus cured, none of them came back except one. People can take a miracle for granted and not be thankful. Perhaps, again, one of the greatest sins that we have. But to go through life and to never say thank you to God, what an awful thing that would be. Amen? What an awful thing. And Paul says this was one of the main causes for the wrath of God to fall on mankind. Unthankfulness. Well, we have to understand we have a sinful nature. The devil's real. He blinds our eyes. He calls us to be unthankful. So many times we may get caught up in this mindset of, what do I have to be thankful for? We feel the pressures of life. We feel like we are, we feel like we're really sacrificing for the Lord, don't we? My hand's up. Two hands are up. If I could get both feet up, I would. Been there. Lord, don't you see I'm sacrificing for you? Lord, don't you understand? And then I have to remind myself, I don't really know if I know what sacrifice is, Brother Carroll. I don't really know if I know what it means to really sacrifice for the Lord. We're so blessed. We're so blessed. You know, we may not be living in luxury today. And if you're a citizen of New Franklin, I know you're not living in luxury. We don't know what luxury is around here, amen. We just thank the Lord we have food in our cabinets, amen, a car to drive, and the Lord's good to us. I'm not complaining at all. We don't live a life of luxury here. But we have to understand there is so much to be thankful for. I mean, we have food, we have shelter, we have clothing. And again, my heart is more thankful today because of the connection back home in Eastern Kentucky of people losing everything they have. we have these things, but most of all, we've got Jesus, and He's our Savior. That's a blessing. I'm thankful for the story of Mel Trotter. Perhaps you've heard his story. And he's someone that was used by the Lord in tremendous ways. But let me give you his story. And this is just tying this into being thankful for God and who He is and how He has saved us. If there was ever a person that you would say there is no hope for, I believe it would have been Mel Trotter. Mel Trotter staggered home drunk one night. He found his wife crying and wringing her hands, and she said, "Mel, our baby is dying. The doctor just left, and he gave me this prescription." And she told him, she said, "Here's 60 cents. She said, I want you to go down to the drugstore, get this prescription filled." And she told him, she said, "Mel, be careful. This is all that we have." Mel Trotter took the money, and he headed for the drugstore. But on the way, he passed a bar, and he went in, and he spent that 60 cents on a drink. That night when he staggered back home, his wife was holding in her arms the lifeless body of their baby. The next day when they buried that baby, Mel was back in the saloon. He sold some of the baby's things and got money for more alcohol. This became even so low to him that Mr. Trotter, he just felt so bad, and he said, "I'm not even fit to live anymore." Mel decided to jump off a bridge in South Chicago. But on his way, he passed the old Pacific Garden Mission. Some of the guys he knew were standing around the door. They said, "You seem nervous, Mel. Come on inside." They pushed him through the door, and he met a man named Harry Monroe, the same man that led Billy Sunday to Christ. And all Mr. Monroe went to work on Mel that day. He shared with him the good news that he could be forgiven, that he could be set free from sin and become a child of God. Mel Trotter accepted God's offer of salvation that night. He came out of darkness into God's marvelous light. And Mr. Trotter went on to found and start 63 gospel missions across America and literally led thousands of people to Christ. I'm thankful that there's nobody too hopeless for God. God specializes in the down and outers. He does. He specializes in those. And I'm thankful tonight we can stand upon Jesus, our rock. Amen. And, every life probably falls into two categories. I'm going to finish with this thought. Every life probably falls into two categories, and that is this: the thankful life or the unthankful life. Two categories. You see, I don't think you can kind of live down the middle. I think you're either unthankful or you're thankful. And I'm thankful for salvation. I'm thankful for God's provisions. I'm thankful that the Lord would use me, that the Lord would allow me to live for Him, that He would allow me to serve Him. Even in our darkest night, we have so much to thank God for. The Bible says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse number 18, "In everything give thanks, for this is what? The will of God." I believe God wants us to be thankful. Young people, can you look at me for just a minute? Let's be thankful for what you have. be thankful for a mom or a dad that would work, provide for you. I mean, listen, they'll just do everything they can to take care of you. Be thankful. Adults, let's be thankful. Amen. Lord, we love you. Thank you for this service. I've enjoyed singing praises to you. Lord, I've enjoyed just reflecting in my own heart on your goodness. We thank you for this fellowship Sunday. And Lord, I pray that these Sundays would strengthen us, would draw us closer to each other as a church family, draw us closer to you as our Father. Lord, as we have a final invitation time today, Lord, we turn it to your hands, speak to hearts, have your will and way. In Christ's name, amen. If you will stand as she plays our invitation song, let's close out today in prayer, thankfulness to the Lord. Amen. He's so good. God is so good to me. If you have a need, let's come today. Let's spend a moment with the Lord.